Hello, everybody. Thank you so much for joining me today. I'm super excited to be talking to you guys about Capelin this afternoon. My name is Chelsea Boaler, and I am a marine ecosystems and fisheries specialist with WWF-Canada since January. And I'm actually working on a couple different projects with WWF that are indirectly related to Capelin. I am working on some restoration projects that focus on golden cod and Arctic char in the southern part of Labrador, as well as the Northern Peninsula. And the reason why I love this work so much is I really love working with communities on conservation projects that align both with WWF Canada's goals as well as community goals. But besides that, I am also finishing up my PhD in fisheries science, and this is where I have learned everything that I know about Capelin. So I have been working with communities all across Labrador, so Northern and Southern Labrador, and also into Quebec Lower North Shore. And this is where I have learned all I know about Capelin and have heard amazing stories, some of which I will share a little bit with you today. But first, before we jump into everything Capelin, I would love to start off with a little bit of trivia. So if you guys have some questions as we go along, feel free to pop them in the comments and I will try and answer all of them. And if I can't get to all of them, we will circle back afterwards, you guys, and get to your questions. And for now, we're going to open up to a couple trivia questions for you. So wait for the cues there. It'll pop the question up and then you can put your answers into the comments and we'll see if you guys get them right. All right, you guys. So the first question is, what is Capelin weather? You have about 40 seconds to get your answers in. So is Capelin weather, is it sunny and hot? Is it cold and dreary? Is it a typhoon? I don't even think we get typhoons over here. What is Capelin weather? When people say Capelin weather, what is it doing outside? Ten more seconds, you guys. Try and answer. What is Capelin weather? Foggy. I think Victoria was the only one who got a proper correct answer there. Foggy, that's right. It's wet and cool and dreary, so it's a pretty typical Newfoundland day. All right, you guys. So we're going to have one more trivia question before I go into a little bit more detail about Capelin. Let's see if you can get this one right. How long do Capelin live? So what is the lifespan of a little Capelin fish? Is it a couple years? Do they live to be 50 years? 30 seconds to come up with an answer. How long do Capelin live? Fifteen more seconds. 3 months. Okay, we have 3 months. Any other guesses? 24 years. It's quite a big difference. Let's see who's closest. 6 months. 2 years. Okay, we got a good range of answers for that one, you guys. Capelin have been known to live up to 6 years. However, in more recent years, we really haven't seen too many 4 years and older. So the typical lifespan of a Capelin is usually around 2 to 3 years. They become sexually mature at 2 years, and then they roll. And usually, most of them die after they spawn and after they roll, especially the males. So, all right, you guys. So I want to talk to you a little bit more about why I have become super obsessed with this tiny little fish. Capelin is a super important species in the Northwest Atlantic. And the reason for that is that they're actually transferring energy from those lower trophic levels, like small little copepods, these little animals that are super tiny, and they eat those. And then now they're jam-packed full of this awesome energy that these larger predators will come and eat. So we have larger fish, we have whales and seals and seabirds, and bears too. Actually, I have some photos that I don't think I shared for this presentation, but of black bears like going along the shoreline and eating Capelin. So it's really, really important for so many different species. Being from Manitoba, I really have never, ever heard about capelin until I moved to Newfoundland and spent so much time up in Labrador. And in other areas like Iceland and the Barents Sea, capelin actually spawn primarily in deep waters. So they kind of mat together all over the bottom of the ocean floor, and the fishers go out into deeper water to fish them. But in Newfoundland and Labrador, as well as into the Gulf of St. Lawrence, we actually get what's called this capelin roll, which is really, really cool. So capelin are actually not, they do spawn in deeper waters a little bit, but they mostly come to beaches to spawn. And they roll right up on the beaches. They roll in with the waves. They're usually going at high tide, usually coming in at high tide. And you can see that the fish are like flopping right on the beach. And there's a really good picture or video coming up where you can see them coming right in with the wave. And I thought this was absolutely crazy. I'd never seen anything like this before, especially being from the prairies. And capelin are just literally rolling in like that. And so during my interviews with some amazing knowledge holders all across Labrador and into the Quebec Lower North Shore region, they were sharing with me about when they were kids. So this is like 30, 40, 50 plus years ago. And they would walk along the beaches and the spawn would be like squishing in their toes and the spawn would be like up to their knees as they were walking along and catching capelin. And I've never, ever seen anything like that. I have seen capelin spawn, but it's not quite as intense as it used to be. And so because in this region where capelin are actually coming to shore to spawn, it's made it a lot easier for people to fish them. People just like me and you going out with buckets and going out with dip nets. And this is one of my favorite pictures that a friend of mine shared with me. And this is from the 1950s. And it shows a Sieur de l'Espérance that's dipping for capelin in L'Anse-aux-Dunes, which is in the Quebec Lower North Shore region. And so this was in the 1950s, and still today we have people. This is my friend and her father in Postville in Labrador. They were out last summer catching capelin using the same dip nets and buckets and everything that folks were using back in the 1950s. So it's a really exciting time for people. They like to do it with their families and their communities get together, and they actually will dry them most of the time. So this is a drying rack. This picture is also from Postville, Labrador. And this is capelin drying, and they salt them, and it makes a great little snack. It's great to take on a boil up or if you're going camping or out to the cabin, because it lasts for a really long time when they're preserved that way. And you can also fry them up fresh and they're pretty tasty. The other applications, I guess, that people would use besides just eating it for their own consumption, they would use it for their sled dogs. They would use it for fertilizer and use it for bait for other fisheries as well. So it's been a really important staple, especially in this part of our country. So I would love to talk a little bit more about how capelin spawn, where do they come from, who comes first, all of that fun stuff. So let's talk a little bit about the differences between the males and the females. So with capelin, they actually become sexually dimorphic. So what that means is that the males and females look different when they get ready to spawn. So males, now pay attention, I might be quizzing you on this later. The males, they have a really defined lateral line across the length of their body. And they also have this really pronounced anal fin as well. So you can see here in the video, Victoria's holding some male capelin. You can see that really pronounced anal fin. And they have this really intense lateral line. And now the females, they have a little bit of a pointier snout and they have this really round belly because they're all full of spawn, getting ready to spawn. So they just have this like, it's like pin, and then it's just like this really big belly that they have carrying around when they're getting ready to spawn. So that is how you can tell the difference. Now, normally the males show up to the beach a little bit before the females and they're hanging out for a couple days. They're not rolling in usually like that. They kind of hang out in deeper water, and then the females will come and they will roll in on the beach. Now, beaches offer a fantastic spawning habitat because they get some protection from that gravel and that sand, but they also are, the eggs are getting really oxygenized. So every time that wave is coming up onto the shoreline, moving all that sediment and those eggs around, they're getting all of this oxygen. And so that really helps with incubation, and it helps the larvae live. And it makes for a really productive habitat. But we have seen capelin do some really strange things as well. So even though beach is the best habitat for them, and we know that they survive best when they spawn on this beach habitat, this gravel and this rock, I have seen them also spawn in some pretty strange places, like on this big sheet of rock. So when I was in Labrador a couple of years ago, we were on this acoustic boat and we were checking out to see what capelin were doing. And we noticed from the boat, these like big yellow patches. And so you can see in this photo here, this is just me looking out from the boat. We're seeing these big yellow patches. And I was like, that can't be capelin eggs. Like, there's a beach right next door. Why aren't they using that? And we went further and we actually saw that they were in fact capelin eggs. We took a little sample of those eggs. And this is what they looked like. So this was after a couple days. So they're really tiny. You can see a little bit of a yellow hue. So that's what we were seeing. We were seeing that reflection. That was in about 6 to 8 feet of water. And so we were seeing that yellow just like shine through the water. And it was very strange because normally it's all mixed up with the sand and sediment from the beach. And you don't see it so distinctly unless you're super close to it. So capelin do have a lot of pressures placed on them. There's top up pressures and bottom down pressures and all this stuff happening. But what research is showing is that capelin are becoming a little bit more adaptable. So they are spawning in different regions. But the thing that we don't quite understand fully is how productive are these areas where they're spawning. So we do know that capelin are spawning a bit later in the season. So instead of spawning at the end of May and into June, they're starting to spawn kind of mid to late June and going all the way to August instead of July. We also know that when they do spawn, they're spawning for a less amount of time. So instead of being on the beach rolling for, say, a week, they might be rolling for a few days. Now, of course, this varies region to region, but these are some general observations that folks have been noticing over the last couple decades. We also notice that they're not using beaches as much. And so that's kind of what I was talking about. When we're not really sure what these deeper water habitats look like, is there enough oxygen getting to the eggs? They might be spawning there, but are the eggs living? And this is all really great research that's currently happening all over the province. So these are some answers that we hope to have more of soon to better understand these changes in capelin spawning dynamics and how that's affecting the ecosystem as a whole. Okay, so what is WWF doing in relation to capelin? So I talked a little bit about my PhD work, you guys, and that is really heavily linked to WWF, but I would love to talk about a couple specific projects that WWF is working on specific to capelin. So the first is a restoration project in Placentia Bay, and this was in 2018 in a spot called Ship Cove. And this was a historical capelin spawning beach that had been previously mined for some sediments for some local development over many, many years. And so capelin weren't coming to this beach anymore, and we thought that it could be potentially related to the sediment that had been removed from the beach. So in 2018, the sediment was properly replaced, and this is just some photos of us doing some of the monitoring after that first year. And in 2018 and 2019, capelin did return to this beach to spawn, so it was really, really exciting to see. Now in Labrador, what we are doing is we are working with partners along the coast to really take stock of any developmental changes over time to see if there's any critical habitats that might have been displaced it by some means, whether that was sediment being removed or coastal construction that was happening. And so right now we're really just in the process of prioritizing certain areas with communities in southern Labrador to see if there's some spots that we can look forward to restoration in future projects. Now the really cool thing that I absolutely love, because I'm a super big fan of citizen science projects, you guys, is the eCapelin platform that we use. So eCapelin is a fantastic website where you can go in and input any of your observations that have to do with capelin. And so this is the map from 2020. So you can already see there's lots of activity happening in the Gulf. And basically this is open to absolutely anybody who would like to contribute. So when they see capelin spawning along the beaches, you can take a photo, you can write any notes in there, you can let us know if you saw males or females, especially now that you know how to tell them apart. You can let us know how much were there. If you're from the region and you understand how this differed from any previous seasons, you can literally leave any comments you would like to leave. And so this is a really great tool for us, not just at WWF, but a lot of academics and folks in government as well, to really see what has been happening year from year. So we have information on this platform all the way back to, I think, early in the 1950s and maybe even earlier. So we can really see how trends are changing. So this is how we're seeing capelin are spawning later in the season, because we're starting the spawning sequence happening late in later months and more recent years. And so this is a really helpful tool, especially because we can't be everywhere all the time. And the people that know the environment best are those who live within those environments. So it's so, so great for people to be able to share. And you guys, you can also see this information. So it's not just like you send it to the website and only we can see it. That website there, the way that you are seeing it is just how you would see it as anybody going to that website. So you can really see what these photos look like and see what capelin rolls look like, even if you're not even from the region. And you can, if you can go on social media, you can hashtag eCapelin. We love to follow all of that activity that's happening. And there's quite a bit happening in the Gulf right now. It's really exciting. And soon we'll see that pick up in Newfoundland as well as up the coast of Labrador. So that is all I have for you guys on Capelin. I did notice a little some questions that I will answer. So I saw one asking about when is the best time to see a Capelin rule. So that really depends on whereabouts you're living. So like I said, right now, Capelin are spawning in the Gulf of St. Lawrence, and then eventually they'll come up to Newfoundland and Labrador. So it really varies. I must say there are folks who used to be able to pinpoint it pretty much to the day, but in the last 10, 15, 20 years, it's become a little bit more sporadic. But if you are in an area for an extended period of time, you will hear rumblings. People will be talking about the Capelin coming to shore and rolling. And then at high tide is usually when they come in. So if you know they're at a beach and they've been there for a couple days, go at high tide, which is sometimes at 4 a.m, but that's when you're going to see them. So that's really exciting. Okay, how big do Capelin get? That depends on the region also. So in my work that I was doing across the coast of Labrador, I would hear people talk about Gulf Capelin and Northern Capelin. And so Gulf Capelin are ones that are coming up from the Gulf, which tend to be a little bit smaller, and Northern Capelin come down from like Greenland area, and then they're coming down this way, and they tend to be a little bit bigger. But then you have folks who talk about Bay Capelin and Outside Capelin. And so this is a term that I've heard mostly in Northern Labrador, some in Southern Labrador. And basically what this is Bay Capelin, we think, are resident Capelin in smaller bays, and they seem to be smaller fish. And then Outside Capelins are the Capelin that are coming in from the outside ocean into bays and communities that typically tend to spawn later in the year, at least from what I have gathered from what people have been telling me. What is your favorite way to eat Capelin? Okay, so I've only tried Capelin two ways. I've tried them fresh and fried up in the pan, and I've tried them dried and salted. So I prefer to have them fresh in the pan. I think they're super, super tasty, just with a little bit of butter or something like that. But having them dried is a great way to be able to take them with you. So it's a great little boost of energy if you're like in the woods or you're going camping or something like that. It's a great way to be able to take it on the go. All right. It's a great time to whale watch. Yes, exactly. So you're going to see, you guys, when Capelin are coming and they are around, you're going to see lots of activity like birds and whales. So lots of times people will see seabirds like diving, and then they'll go to that spot and they can see a whole bunch of Capelin. That is a lot of the time. That is how we on the boats, on the acoustic boats and working with the communities, that's how we would kind of pick out where the Capelin were, is that we could see all this bird activity. All right. How big? Okay. Talked about that. I think I got most of the questions. Okay. I think I got most of your questions, you guys. Is the population stable? So the last, I actually don't think that the last bit of information was released from Department of Fisheries and Oceans. The meeting was actually just in March. And just with everything going on, I'm not quite sure if that has been released yet. I don't believe it has been. So we will learn a lot more about the status of the stock, hopefully in the next few weeks. So stay tuned for that, because I'm sure that there will be lots of information provided also from WWF once that gets released publicly. Awesome. Is there where you see cities? Sorry, I'm trying to read these as well, you guys. To collect date via the website eCapelin, is there a way to see the cities where they are spotted? Yes, exactly. So when you go on to eCapelin, you can zoom in to the regions. And I'm not actually sure if like the names of the cities are there, but you should be able to see the provinces and kind of follow it along. There's another couple of really great information pages just on Facebook. So there's one called the Labrador Aquatic Observer Network. That's part of my research, where folks from Labrador are putting information on there. And then there's another one called Info Capelin, and that is from Quebec. And so I am in that group as well. And you can really see people are like, when are they rolling? I'm seeing them here. Are they going to roll here next? So if you're kind of wanting to see that happen and see kind of the timing of that, that's another really great page. And I'll get, I don't think I gave that Quebec link into our communications people, but I will give it to them so that you guys have a chance to take a look at that. Awesome. Okay, so I think that is all the questions, and I am going to move on to some more trivia so we don't go too over time. So I have a few more trivia questions for you. All right, you guys. So I talked to you about what the difference is between females and males. So let's see if you can pick out which one the male is. And I just got the note to speak slower. Thank you, Carolyn. I will do that. And if you have any questions about anything I talked about, you can type in the comments. So which one is male? Is it A or is it B? I got some A's, I got some B's. Five more seconds. The answer is A. So I think most of you guys said A a little bit. A few said B, but the reason it's A, if you guys check out the anal fin right at the bottom of the fish, that is really indicative of the males, and you can also see a really clear lateral line. It's a bit darker on the top of the fish and silvery on the bottom, and the female has that big belly. All right, so the second question, why do beaches make for really great spawning habitat? So what is it about beaches? And this one I covered a little bit in the talk, so hopefully you guys picked up on that. Why do beaches make good spawning habitat for capelin? We got oxygen, we got gravel and sand, sediments. These are great answers, you guys. So I think everyone who put an answer in got that right, and that's absolutely right. So you have this great sediment that the eggs are sticking to, and then you have this awesome wave action that's coming in that's oxygenating the eggs. So all of those answers were correct. Great job, you guys. All right, so this one I covered in my chat as well. If you guys caught it, do males or females typically show up to spawn first? So who's hanging out waiting? Is it the females or the males? We got males and females. Guesses coming through. Males just like the necklace. Cheeky. Five more seconds. That's right. The males typically come first. So again, they kind of tend to hang out in a little bit deeper water. They're not going to roll right up on the beaches. So they're typically there for a couple days, and then the females show up before the capelin actually start rolling. I think we have one more question left. And this one, I did not say in my talk, so you could guess anything, but I'll give you a little hint. It is a type of food, and it is a vegetable that it smells like. So 25 seconds. What do capelin smell like? And I'm talking about capelin when they're in the water, not when you're frying them up in a pan or have them dried. So if you were out on a boat watching capelin come in, or you were standing along the beach, what do they smell like? We got guesses are fish, eggplant. The answer is cucumbers. And I thought this was absolutely crazy until I was out on the water and got a whiff of cucumber when the capelin were coming in. So I'm not entirely sure why that is, but it's this really fresh smelling smell. It actually smells quite nice. And it's definitely not what they smell like when they're drying, trust me. So thank you guys so much for tuning in with us today. I hope you learned a little something about capelin today. If you had a question that I didn't catch in the comments, we will be going back to answer those. So be patient with us, and over the next couple of days, we will get those answers to you. I encourage you guys to tune into all of our Wildlife Wednesday segments. And if you guys have a suggestion for what animal you would like to learn a little bit more about, just pop a message in the comments below or tune into any of our social media pages and just let us know what you'd like to hear, and we will hopefully get that up to you soon. And like I said, you guys, that Eat Capelin website is awesome. So if you are in a region where capelin spawn, please go on there and share with us what you are seeing. And if you're not from here but just want to check it out, I would encourage you to do the same. Thank you so much, you guys. Have an awesome Wednesday.